The truth is a very important thing. We come here to this building 3 times a week to seek after the truth. And I study hard every day to make sure that what I'm presenting to you is the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help me God. And the reason that truth is so important is because Jesus, our King, has said, "If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Being a disciple of Jesus is all about living within his teachings. Plus, being his disciple means that we will inherit eternal life. And Jesus, who cannot tell a lie, explained that if we abide in his word, then we will know the truth, and the truth will make us free. So, being a follower of Jesus means that we have a very close relationship with the truth. And Jesus even prayed to the Father, "Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth." So clearly, to be a true disciple of Jesus, we must have a very close, dependent relationship with the Word of God. Since God's Word and the truth are the same thing, according to our Savior. About the truth, David wrote, "The entirety of your Word is truth, and every one of your righteous judgments endures forever." And Paul also said, "For this reason, we also thank God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you welcomed it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe." We see over and over again that the truth and the word of God are the same thing. Neither Peter, Paul, James, John, or any other New Testament leader ever claimed that the church was the truth or that tradition was truth. They only claimed that the Bible was truth. And they admonished us to hold fast to the scriptures because unlike every other thing on this earth, the scriptures cannot be defiled. Peter explained, "Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the Word of God, which lives and abides forever, because all flesh is as grass. And all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. The grass withers, and its flower falls away. But the word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you." The Apostle Peter tells us that the word of God is incorruptible, and it lives and remains forever. And he contrasted the Bible against each and every person when he said that all flesh, meaning every human being, is like grass. Every human being on earth will wither, and every human being on earth is corruptible. But you can always trust the truth of God's word because it'll endure from age to age without decay. So, when Paul commands us all to test all things and hold fast to that which is good and abstain from every form of evil, we have to ask, what does Paul want us to test all things in comparison to? Or, in other words, what is the standard of truth that we must test every single thing in our lives against? Some claim that the standard is tradition. But Jesus once said, "All too well, you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your tradition." And Jesus wasn't happy, friends, when he said this. He was rebuking the Pharisees for following tradition in the place of the Word of God. And Peter wrote about the aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers. So Peter didn't put much stock in tradition either. Some claim that the standard is educated men, or a specific group of men, or even a majority. But Peter also said, we ought to obey God rather than men. So Peter and the other apostles didn't believe that tradition or man should be our ultimate judge of truth. They taught that the word of God is what we must test all things by. That's why the Bible mentions the Bereans positively, even when they double-checked the preaching of Paul the Apostle. In the Spirit, Luke writes, then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. When they arrived, they went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness and searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. You see, it's good to search the scriptures to verify what any human being is saying, because human beings in tradition, even stacked up together, can't ever equal the authority of the Word of God. The Word of God stands in a class all by itself, and even Jesus treated it that way when he said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And the Lord's warning to the Sadducees is a warning to us all when he told them, you are mistaken, not knowing the scriptures nor the power of God. So today, in our effort to seek after truth and avoid the mistakes of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, I'll be sharing with you the truth about Easter, including its origins, traditions, and practices. And we'll also see what the Word of God commands us to do with days like Easter. And because this study is dealing directly with something that we all grew up with, it can be a little hard to swallow the first time you hear it. So, along with the writer of Hebrews, I want to encourage you by saying, for everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who, by reason of use, have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. And this verse applies to our topic today, because it's easy to swallow teaching from Scripture that doesn't challenge your understanding of the world. But when the Bible reveals that something you hold dear is offensive to God, it can be very hard to chew and swallow. Milk, like the positive promises in the Word of God, is easy to swallow. But admonishment against a long-held tradition of the majority is like meat. And these things require deeper commitment and discernment from us as followers of the Messiah. And with this in mind, our first impartial source explains, before Christ was born, the people living in Northern Europe had a goddess called Eostre, the goddess of the spring. Every year in the spring, the people had a festival for her. The name of our spring festival, Easter, comes from the name Eostre. So, our first clue about Easter is that it existed before Jesus was born. So, how could a pagan festival that predates the birth of Jesus Christ possibly be an authorized celebration of his resurrection? Truly, the Bible never mentions Easter, only the seven feasts of the Lord from Leviticus 23, and only one ridiculous mistranslation of Acts 12:4 supports Easter, because men wrongly translated the Greek word for Passover as Easter. No Greek lexicon or dictionary agrees with that absurd translation, and instead, they all correct it. About this obvious mistranslation, Vine's expository dictionary explains, Pascha, translated Easter in Acts 12:4 in the King James Version, denotes the Passover. The phrase, after the Passover, signifies after the whole festival was at an end. The term Easter is not of Christian origin. It is another form of Astarte, one of the titles of the Chaldean goddess, the Queen of Heaven. From this Pash, the pagan festival of Easter was quite distinct and was introduced into the apostate Western religion as part of the attempt to adapt pagan festivals into Christianity. And respected commentator Albert Barnes wrote about the King James translation of Acts 12:4, "There never was a more absurd or unhappy translation than this. The original is simply after the Passover. The word Easter now denotes the festival observed by many Christian churches in honor of the resurrection of the Savior. But the original has no reference to that. The word Easter is of Saxon origin and is supposed to be derived from Eostre, the goddess of love, or the Venus of the North, in honor of whom a festival was celebrated by our pagan ancestors in the month of April." Easton's Bible Dictionary adds, "Easter is originally a Saxon word, denoting a goddess of the Saxons, in honor of whom sacrifices were offered about the time of Passover. Hence, the name came to be given to the festival of the resurrection of Christ, which occurred at the time of the Passover. When the Authorized Version was formed, the word Passover was used in all passages in which this word Pascha occurred, except in Acts 12:4. In the Revised Version, the proper word Passover is always used." And the International Standard Bible Encyclopedia confirms about the name of Easter. "The term Easter was derived from the Anglo-Saxon Eostre, the name of the goddess of spring. In her honor, sacrifices were offered at the time of the vernal equinox." Plus, even the Holman Bible Dictionary records, "The English word Easter comes from the name of the Anglo-Saxon goddess of the dawn." This is well established in secular sources also, because, as the Canadian Encyclopedia explains, according to the Venerable Bede, a Christian scholar, the word Easter came from the Old English Eastre, which was probably from the Germanic Eostre, the great mother goddess of the Saxon people who was associated with spring and new life. And the New World Encyclopedia states, "The English name Easter is thought to derive from the name of an Anglo-Saxon goddess of the dawn called Eostre or Eastre in various dialects of Old English and Ostara in German. In England, the annual festival time in her honor was in the month of Easter, equivalent to April." The Dictionary of Word Origins, under the heading of Easter, says, "This is from Anglo-Saxon Eostre, a pagan goddess whose festival came at the spring equinox." Compton's Encyclopedia and Fact Index repeats what we have heard from dozens of separate sources, namely, the name Easter comes from Eostre, an ancient Anglo-Saxon goddess, originally of the dawn. In pagan times, an annual spring festival was held in her honor. Plus, Funk and Wagnall's Encyclopedia explains, "Easter is the Anglo-Saxon name of a Teutonic goddess of spring and fertility to whom was dedicated a month corresponding to April. Her festival was celebrated on the day of the vernal equinox. Traditions associated with the festival survive in the Easter rabbit, a symbol of fertility, and in colored Easter eggs, originally painted with bright colors to represent the sunlight of spring and used in Easter egg rolling contests or given as gifts." And the Columbia Encyclopedia explains about the word Easter that it is from the Old English Eastre, name of a spring goddess. So, the origin of the name Easter is most certainly not biblical, and instead it's the name of a pagan goddess. But the word of God, and God himself said, "In all that I have said to you, be circumspect, and make no mention of the name of other gods, nor let it be heard from your mouth." Friends, today, in order to destroy this detestable idol, I will mention her disgusting name. But you can be sure that this word does not intentionally cross my lips unless I'm teaching against it. Yet, millions of churches around the world this week will be printing the name of a pagan goddess, saying the name of a pagan goddess, and wishing people a happy pagan goddess day, all while not knowing the origins of the name they're using. But our God clearly commanded that we not use the names of other gods. But sadly, things get even worse when we trace this disgusting name back in time. So we'll begin with a quote from the Biblical Archaeological Review, written by Larry Baumler, who said, "She was the great mother goddess of the Saxon people in Northern Europe. Similarly, the Teutonic goddess of fertility was known variously as Ostari, Ostara, Ostern, Eostra, Eostre, Eostur, Eostra, Eostur, Eostron, and Ossos." You see, because the pagans don't have any age-enduring scriptures to guide them into all truth, they change the name of their deities at will. But no matter what name they use, they're still worshiping the same demons. And once we trace the name back in time, we learn, in ancient Anglo-Saxon myth, Ostara is the personification of the rising sun. In that capacity, she is associated with the spring and is considered to be a fertility goddess. She is the friend of all children, and to amuse them, she changed her pet bird into a rabbit. This rabbit brought forth brightly colored eggs, which the goddess gave to the children as gifts. From her name and rites, the festival of Easter is derived. Ostara is identical to the Greek Eos and the Roman Aura. And another source records, Eostre, the Teutonic Anglo-Saxon goddess of the dawn, evolved from Astarte in Babylon and from Ishtar from Assyria. Eggs, dyed blood red and rolled in the newly sown soil at spring equinox, ensured fertility of the fields. The moon hare, sacred animal totem of Eostre, laid colored eggs for children to find. From the name Eostre, Astarte, and Ishtar, we derive the scientific terminology for the female hormone and reproduction cycle, estrogen and estrus. Easter also derives from Eostre. But most importantly, Easter can be found indirectly in the Word of God if we trace her back far enough. For example, Encyclopedia Britannica explains about the predecessor of Easter, Astarte, also spelled Athart or Ashtart, was the great goddess of the ancient Middle East and chief deity of Tyre, Sidon, and Eilat, important Mediterranean seaports. Hebrew scholars now feel that the goddess Ashtoreth, mentioned so often in the Bible, is a deliberate conflation of the Greek name Astarte and the Hebrew word boshet, shame, indicating the Hebrews' contempt for her cult. Ashtoreth, the plural form of the goddess's name in Hebrew, became a general term denoting goddesses and paganism. You see, the devout Hebrews wouldn't even record the direct name of this false goddess, but churches everywhere are associating this unholy name with the glorious name of Jesus Christ. And as we've seen in a few sources so far, the name is not the only connection to these false gods. There are also distinct practices that conclusively prove the origins of this pagan festival. For example, the Encyclopedia Britannica states, under the heading of Easter, the egg, as a symbol of fertility and of renewed life, goes back to the ancient Egyptians and Persians, who had also the custom of coloring and eating eggs during their spring festival. And the New Standard Encyclopedia explains, the exchange of Easter eggs, which symbolize new life and fertility, is one of the oldest traditions. Rabbits and flowers are also pagan fertility symbols. You see, as Funk and Wagnall's Standard Dictionary of Folklore, Mythology, and Legend concludes, this Easter egg hunting is not mere child's play, but the vestige of a fertility rite. And even the so-called Easter lily has long been revered by pagans of various lands as a holy symbol associated with the reproductive organs. And the New Encyclopedia Britannica writes, the hare, the symbol of fertility in ancient Egypt, a symbol that was later kept in Europe, is not found in North America. Its place was taken by the Easter rabbit, the symbol of fertility and periodicity, both human and lunar, accredited with laying eggs in nests prepared for it at Easter or with hiding them away for children to find. Encyclopedia Britannica goes on to say, it's quite probable that the word bun has a far older and more interesting origin, as it is suggested by an inquiry into the origin of hot cross buns. These cakes, which are now solely associated with the Christian Good Friday, are traceable to the remotest period of pagan history. Cakes were offered by ancient Egyptians to the moon goddess, and these had imprinted on them a pair of horns, symbolic of the ox at the sacrifice of which they were offered on the altar, or of the horned moon goddess, the equivalent of Ishtar, of the Assyrio-Babylonians. The Greeks offered such sacred cakes to Astarte, Easter, and other divinities. And finally, churches aren't alone in their celebration of Easter, because witches still celebrate it by its original name. In A History of Witchcraft, Jeffrey B. Russell writes, witches celebrate 8 major festivals, or sabbats, each year. The first is Yule in December, celebrating the winter solstice, and March the 20th or 21st, Aostre, the vernal equinox, is a fertility festival. So, now you may be asking, how did a pagan fertility goddess of spring, who can clearly be traced back to Ashtoreth, the so-called Queen of Heaven, become associated with Christianity, even with her bunny, the eggs, the hot cross buns, and the rest of her pagan fertility symbols? Well, it began with anti-Semitism and a desire to incorporate pagan practices into the church to unify the Roman Empire. And we know this because Emperor Constantine himself wrote, it appeared an unworthy thing that in the celebration of this most holy feast, we should follow the practice of the Jews, who have impiously defiled their hands with enormous sin, and are therefore deservedly afflicted with blindness of soul. Let us then have nothing in common with the detestable Jewish crowd. And he added in another disgusting letter, it was in the first place declared improper to follow the custom of the Jews in the celebration of this holy festival, because their hands having been stained with crime, the mind of these wretched men are necessarily blinded. Let us then have nothing in common with the Jews, who are our adversaries, for how can they entertain right views on any point who, after having compassed the death of the Lord, being out of their minds, are guided not by sound reason, but by an unrestrained passion, wherever their innate madness carries them. Lest your pure minds should appear to share in the customs of a people so utterly depraved, Therefore, this irregularity must be corrected in order that we may no more have anything in common with those parricides and the murderers of our Lord. We should have no single point in common with the perjury of the Jews. And this is why the Council of Nicaea, convened by that same Emperor Constantine in 325, decreed that Easter should be observed on the first Sunday following the first full moon after the spring equinox. Easter, therefore, can fall on any Sunday between March 22nd and April 25th. In 325 AD, under the leadership of a politically motivated, anti-Semitic Roman emperor who wanted nothing to do with the Jews, even though they were properly observing the biblical feasts, a vast portion of the church left their firm anchor of the Word of God, and they set themselves adrift from the Bible by intentionally choosing to observe a pagan holiday. The Feast of First Fruits, as recorded in the Word of God, is the day the Lord rose from the dead, and we will demonstrate that in the coming weeks, so you can be absolutely sure that not one of the Lord's apostles would have ever considered celebrating any feast named after a pagan deity. And this fact isn't hard to discover. The Catholic world even wrote, "The church took the pagan philosophy and made it the buckler of faith against the heathen. She took the pagan Roman pantheon, temple of all the gods, and made it sacred to the martyrs, so that it stands to this day. She took the pagan Sunday and made it the Christian Sunday. She took the pagan Easter and made it the feast we celebrate during this season." Friends, we cannot adopt pagan days or redeem them. Instead, the undefiled, unfading, and pure Word of God says, "You shall utterly destroy the places where the nations which you shall dispossess serve their gods. On the high mountains, and on the hills, and under every green tree, you shall destroy their altars, break their sacred pillars, and burn their wooden images with fire. You shall cut down the carved images of their gods and destroy their names from that place. You shall not worship the Lord your God with such things." And because the faithful church obeyed this verse, the Encyclopedia Britannica records, "There is no indication of the observance of the Easter festival in the New Testament or in the writings of the Apostolic Fathers. The sanctity of special times was an idea absent from the mind of the first Christians, who continued to observe the Jewish festivals, though in a new spirit, as commemorations of events which those festivals had foreshadowed. Thus, the Passover, with a new conception added to it of Christ as the true Paschal Lamb, and the first fruits from the dead, continued to be observed." So today, I have shared with you the truth, and I didn't shrink back from declaring the facts and the whole counsel of God to you in regards to Easter. We have used as many sources as we could fit in our time today so that you could see that Easter is most certainly a perversion of the true worship of our Almighty God. The choice about how you handle Easter is up to you. But I can promise you with absolute confidence that our God is not pleased with the incorporation of pagan names and ceremonies into the worship of His precious Son. And He commands us all, over and over again in His Word, to flee from every form of idolatry, and not even to mention the foul names of those demonic false gods that the pagans serve.